This is BBC Radio Wales. I'm Dot Davis. And first up this morning, I'm waiting for your calls, your comments on the biggest news story of the week. The Home Secretary, Amber Rudd, says the attempted murder of ex-Russian spies Sergei Skripal and his daughter Julia using a nerve agent was a brazen and reckless act. Mr. Skripal and his daughter are still critically ill after being found collapsed on a bench in Salisbury City Centre on Sunday. A police officer who was in intensive care is now stable and conscious. Counter-terrorism officers are working to find the origin of the very rare nerve agent. And Defence Secretary Gavin Williamson says Russia is becoming an ever greater threat amid speculation the attack could have some element of state involvement. Your reaction to the story, please. If it is Russia, should we be scared? Should we retaliate? Sam Green is director of the Russia Institute at King's College London, and Dr. Andrew Foxall is director of the Russia and Eurasia Study Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. Good morning to you both.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dan.
Morning. Sam, I'm going to start with you. Is Russia involved, do you think?
I mean, that's a question for which we don't have any evidence, right? I think that most of us who are watching this and most of us who, you know, watch Russia would probably be fairly surprised if the evidentiary trail doesn't eventually lead across that border. You know, this is a rule of law-based system, and particularly if both prosecutors and, you know, foreign secretaries want to get anywhere with this, they're going to have to wait and follow the evidence rather than lead it, I think.
I mean, it's inevitable that we draw comparisons to the Alexander Litvinenko case, isn't it? How similar are they?
Well, I mean, they're similar to a degree. I think the similarity actually is sort of in the dangerousness of the attack and the tactic, right? The fact that this has knock-on consequences for public safety, not just obviously for the person who is the immediate target of the attack, and that raises questions to which any government anywhere around the world would have to respond, and it raises important questions about the intentions and the command and control structure within Russia itself. But there are some important differences, right? Mr. Skripal has not led the kind of life that Litvinenko was leading, at least as far as we're aware. He had kept his head down. He had not been an open and public dissident and critic of the Russian government and of Mr. Putin personally. And so if the motivations in attacking Litvinenko were fairly clear, here it's a lot more murky.
What about the damage that this does, again, to our relation in Britain with Russia? Because when you look at the language being used by the Home Secretary saying it's a brazen and reckless act, you see the Defence Secretary, Gavin Williamson, saying that Russia is becoming an ever greater threat. These are very strong sentences.
Well, I mean, first of all, this is rhetoric we've been hearing for a while, and Russia has done a lot of things in recent years that have made people very nervous and very skeptical about its intentions, whether it is the Litvinenko attack or Russia's role in Ukraine, to say nothing of Syria, and Russia's alleged role in various elections and referenda and things around the world, right? So there is reason for governments to be worried, but I think, again, given that we don't have the evidence, I think what we've seen is the government trying to get out ahead of any potential accusations that they are being or could even be accused of being soft on Russia.
Let me bring in Dr. Andrew Foxall. What could the UK realistically do? We're hearing here, you know, there will be a reaction if there's found to be state involvement. But what can the UK realistically do if it's proved that there is Russian involvement?
I mean, to answer the question, I just go back to the case of Alexander Litvinenko, comparisons with which have already been made, as you've said. The UK's response to that was initially quite robust. Russian intelligence officers were expelled from London. Contact between the UK intelligence community and Russia's FSB were reduced to a minimum. But relations between London and Moscow soon returned to what we might call business as usual. And in a sense, the UK's response, looking back, was pretty weak and too little, too late. In many respects, Russia murdered a British citizen on the streets of London and got away with it. Now, in terms of what we can do going forward, Russia's Achilles heel is its dependence on the Western financial system. Its elites use capital markets and payment systems to launder their ill-gotten gains and to loot and legitimize that money as well. So there are a range of tools at the disposal of the UK government if, and you know, I would be echo Sam's caution, if Russia is proven to have been involved. There are a range of things that the UK could do. It's already been mentioned over recent days that Russia's ambassador, Alexander Yakovenko, could be expelled from the UK. Major money laundering investigations could be launched into Russian money in our financial system. Due diligence procedures that are undertaken by UK financial institutions could be more tightly enforced. Unexplained wealth orders, which recently came into force, could be used against potentially illicit Russian wealth in the UK. Russia's first deputy prime minister, for example, a gentleman called Igor Shuvalov, is suspected of owning two flats in 4 Whitehall Court, which is just 10 minutes' walk from Parliament. Now, his and his wife's joint wealth is equivalent to about £600,000, but the flats are worth in excess of £11 million. There are questions to be asked about that. Longer term, what the UK could do is adopt Magnitsky-esque legislation. Now, this could be passed as part of Brexit-related legislation, not least the sanctions and money laundering bill. And what this would do is introduce powers for government ministers to freeze the assets of individuals from Russia, but also from elsewhere, who are guilty of gross human rights abuses, and it would ban them from the UK. The US has already passed that sort of legislation. It did so in 2012. Since then, other Western allies have done so, including Canada, Estonia, and Lithuania. So there are a multitude of possible responses, but I would just emphasize that not all of them would be visible. The UK has, for example, offensive cyber capabilities that could be deployed. I'm not saying they would be, but they could be deployed, and it's not necessarily the case that we in the public would know to what use those capabilities have been put.
Well, if you both don't mind staying with me, I'm going to have to go to a disc, but so many questions need to be asked here. How worried should we really be? Are we in a new Cold War? Stay with me. We'll try and answer those questions very shortly after this disc. This is Dusty Springfield. Dusty Springfield on BBC Radio Wales. I'm asking for your response this morning, your reaction to the biggest story of the week, the attempted murder of a former Russian double agent, Sergei Skripal, and his daughter Yulia, both targeted with nerve agents, very rare nerve agents apparently, with Britain vowing to act without hesitation if Russia is found to be responsible. Your reaction to this story, please. How scared are you? Do you think we should retaliate? 03700 100 110. The lines are open for you to have your say, or you can text me on 81012. My guests, Sam Green, who's director of the Russia Institute at King's College London, and Dr. Andrew Foxall, director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. Thank you both for staying with me. I just want to read a couple of texts I've had here to you both. This from Chris in Drenewydd. It makes me laugh when you hear Britain will take strong action. It's like something from a film, Boris and Amber Rudd making speeches with their serious faces. Russia could crush us with its little finger, and all we can do is wave our little finger. By the way, have we got any fighter jets to put in our carriers yet? That's from Chris in Drenewydd. And this is a really good point here from Dave in Llandybia. And what exactly can we do to Russia if found guilty? Military response is out of the question. Is that true, Andrew? Military response is absolutely out of the question.
I think it depends by what we mean by a military response. I don't think by any stretch of the imagination what would be out of the question is for the UK, in a sense, to further some of the work that it's done over recent years. So I mean, London has supported NATO's new push for to reassure our allies and its frontline states in Eastern Europe. We recently led the alliance's Baltic Air policing mission, and we've deployed 850 soldiers to Estonia. What we may see is we may be at the forefront, in a sense, of pushing for these for similar sorts of actions, not new actions, but simply reinforcing existing military deployments and commitments that we've already made. I think it's highly unlikely that we would see the UK, however, acting unilaterally in a military sense against Russia.
This from Winford and Punta Dawa, who says, I think that the investigation into the incident should be allowed to take its full course before we come to any conclusions. It's difficult to know what we can do. Do we act in isolation ourselves, or do we ask our European partners to join us? There are many complex questions to be answered. And there's a deafening silence, isn't there, from our European neighbours on this, Andrew?
Our European neighbours, I think, have been very understandably been very cautious in saying anything about this. And I would emphasise that in some senses, so too have our own government. The government has emphasised that this is still an ongoing investigation, and that the investigation must run its course. I mean, it seems clear to me, however, that whatever action the UK government does take, if Russian involvement is proven, of course, the impact of this action will be much greater if it's coordinated with our NATO, European Union, and other Western allies. Now, it's likely, I think, that action would centre on rallying international support to make a stand against all forms of Russian subversion and mischief making, and that would include, for example, its interference in democratic processes, which is, say, elections. So, in a sense, from elections and energy supplies through to propaganda and military coercion, it would be, I would imagine, a very much a rounded approach to Russia's aggressions. Russia's aggressions, let's not forget, this isn't anything new. The one of the reasons why, as Sam suggested earlier, people have been quick to jump to the conclusion that Russian state is involved is because it fits a pattern. Now, that pattern didn't start in 2014 when Russia illegally annexed Crimea and conducted an invasion of eastern Ukraine. It goes back much before then. There's, of course, the war with Georgia in 2008. There are the cyber attacks in Estonia in 2007. There is Russia's own war against Chechnya in between 1999 and 2000. I willingly and wholly admit that there are specificities and complexities to those situations, but this pattern of behaviour isn't anything new.
Yeah, and this pattern of behaviour, this mistrust of Vladimir Putin globally, Sam, how big of an issue is that for Putin?
Well, I mean, it depends on what kind of time frame you're looking at, right? So Putin is facing, if you can call it that, re-election on the 18th of March, right? And within sort of that time frame, from here up until then, that is this kind of dynamic actually plays to his strengths, right? So he's built his campaign and his appeal around the sense of confrontation and conflict with the West. In his his supporters, not him personally, but even in his public speeches, right? He has talked about new nuclear missile systems and taken a fairly militaristic tone. So there is this sense that Russia is at war with the West, and of course that now is not the time to change your leadership, if anybody would have countenanced that anyway.
Yes. So is this? I mean, that's the burning question now, and that's what everybody's talking about. Are we entering a new Cold War here? Really briefly, Andrew.
I don't think that the phrase a new Cold War is particularly useful at all. The situation that we're in is very, very different to the situation that we're in between 1945, 1946, and 1991. That being said, it's useful to help frame the debate, but it can also obscure the complexities and details of exactly what's going on.
Thank you both so much for joining me this morning on BBC Radio Wales. I'd love to know what you make of what you've heard. Are you worried? Are you scared of what's going on with Russia? 03700 100 110.